country known as the Land of the Rising Sun, famed for tradition and beauty, and to its iconic capital city, Tokyo, a vibrant cultural modern metropolis. Japan is the birthplace of judo, and Tokyo's Kodokan is the mecca for all judoka. So where better a place for the world's elite athletes to come together and train in the build-up to the final tournament on the International Judo Federation's 2014 World Tour. The Tokyo Grand Slam traditionally has one of the strongest entries in world judo, and this year was no exception, with Olympic and world champions from across the globe taking part. Not to mention a host nation, a team full of household names in Japan who took time out to meet some of the fans who would be supporting their heroes throughout the weekend. A special signing session which enabled the children to meet some of the modern day legends of Japanese judo. Tokyo is the hardest of all tournaments for a foreigner to win a medal at. But one thing is for sure, everyone would be giving it their all at the Tokyo Metropolitan Gymnasium. And where better to start than at under 78 kilograms, where USA's world and Olympic champion, Kayla Harrison, was in line for an acid test against Japan's best. Harrison has been a little off the boil since winning the Olympics, but is starting to sharpen up as she looks ahead to the Rio Olympics. First up for Harrison was Abitakar of Slovenia, who Harrison put away for Ippon after holding her down. 2011 world silver medalist Ogata was next up for Harrison. Harrison took less than 20 seconds to make the first move, burying Ogata and scoring a yuko. And she wasn't done there, flying in with another hip throw and scoring a wazari before moving straight into an ippon scoring hold. Harrison was through to the semi-final. There she was up against another Japanese fighter, Hamada. Once again, Harrison was ruthless. She didn't give Hamada an inch on the ground, chasing around her legs and securing a pin. Three ippons from three contests. How would Harrison get on in the final against her last Japanese opponent? Harrison certainly started to come back onto form. This is what she wants, just coming to the end of the year, and it will set her up well for 2015.
How do it?
Sato, trying to save face here for the Japanese national squad. Harrison, straight away though, dominating the sleeve. She'll want that arm over the top as well. Sato knows what's going to come. Arm over the top, now she's got it. Now what's going to happen? Oh, that's what's going to happen! A wazari straight away for Kayla Harrison. Harai Makikomi, she wanted that arm over, the hips came across, and she hit the ground with a thud. So now Sato got it all to do. She's got to come forwards all the time. Harrison already beaten Ogata and Hamada. So this will be the third Japanese fighter in this tournament. Sato now with a boxing idea. She's really taking the fight now to Harrison. Harrison got a block out. She's got to make sure that she keeps her cool. So seconds ticking away. Harrison blocking out. Can she do it? This will be a great win for Harrison. There it is. She wins here in Japan. She's beaten Ogata, Hamada, and now Sato to win this tournament, and she has come on form at just the right time. Harai Makikomi did it, that big arm over the top dominated their head. She is the first American to win this event, men or women, and what a way to end the year.
I started my comeback in June, and it's sort of been all about building back up my confidence and working on getting my instincts back and getting sort of the feel of judo back. And that was really an instinct move. She came in and I turned and got a good score, got a wazari from it, and I was able to hold on to that for the remainder of the match. So that was exactly what I've been working for this year. I feel like I was talking with my teammate Nick, and we were like, basically you just won the Japanese Nationals, so it's good, it's tough, you know, the crowd is with them and they're fired up to fight, and I just knew that I wanted I wanted to end the year on a high note and get ready for the last big push for Rio. So it felt really good.
At the lightest female weight, Japan boasts their newest rising star, 19-year-old world champion Kondo. Kondo is an exciting talent that showed off her incredible throwing power in the early rounds with a huge Oguruma. That set up a mouth-watering all-Japanese final against former double world champion Asami. In a frenetic start to the contest, Kondo caught Asami napping, throwing her with Tominagi for the eventual match-winning yuke. Kondo's meteoric rise continues. One weight up at under 52 kilograms, it was another All-Japan final as Hashimoto took on Nishida. In a tight match, Hashimoto was relieved to confirm her place as Japanese number one, narrowly winning out by a single Shido. As she left the tatami, she was emotional as she accepted the applause of the home crowd. At over 78 kilograms, there was yet another Japan-Japan final, as Asahina took on Inamura. It was Inamura who struck. A beautiful driving Ojigari placed Asahina flat on her back for Ippon. A wonderful combination of speed, power and technique from Inamura, earning her first gold medal on the IJF World Circuit. One of the best moments of the Tokyo Grand Slam came in the final of the under 63 kilos category between Italy's Edwige Gwen and top seed from Slovenia, Tina Trešinjak. Well, Trešinjak is the lady on form, and she looks so determined coming out here. Gwen, though, she also is having a great tournament. Look at that. Straight into the attack here. She really looks determined here. Really taking the fight. So aggressive, looking for the grip all the time. Oso Tagari. Oh, that was close. And Oso Tagari. And Gwen goes cleanly onto her back. And Trešinjak there. She started at such a pace. And look at that, she pulls on that sleeve trying to get it free and then just skips across round the back of Gwen for the Taniotosh and absolutely directs her onto her back. She really changes with the head and that's the most important thing there. She controls it from the upper part of the body and she wins the gold medal. One weight up at under 70 kilograms saw the entry of double world champion and man of France. She was able to celebrate back-to-back victories on the IJF World Tour after beating Japan's Takemoto. Since moving back up to her preferred weight of under 70 kilograms, Iman has looked stronger than ever. And even at the age of 32, should surely be considered one of the favorites for next year's World Championships. There was another Jeju winner at under 60 kilograms, the shape of Korea's Kim, who took on Japan Shishimi in the final. It was Kim who celebrated the win and put himself on top of the podium. Two wins in 2 weeks for the Korean. At under 100 kilograms, it was another Korean, Cho, faced the final against Francis Marais. Cho out-attacked the Frenchman and eventually took the win on penalties. Korean has now established himself as a real force in the under 100 kilos category. But the star of the show for Korea was at under 90 kilograms in the shape of Gwak. Last week in Jeju, Gwak took gold in spectacular style. And he carried on where he left off here in Tokyo. First, he blasted past Nibali. Then, he saw off Egypt's Darwin, which set up a final against home favorite Nishiyama. Could Nishiyama stop Wack? This match, very tight. Nishiyama coming forwards, predominantly left-handed. So's Gwak, though. Trying to attack the outside leg, trying to get it back. Oh, Jigari, this time Nishiyama! Oh, Gwak! And he gets the score back! And he took advantage of that hopping Oh, Jigari there from Nishiyama. Nishiyama, hooked in. He can change direction on a sixpence, can Nishiyama. But he ran on to the drop Tsunagi, and Gwak had a second stab at it. So Nishiyama now piling on the pressure. Gwak just needs to defend, and he does. And he wins his second title in 2 weeks. He was the winner in Jeju. Now he's the winner in Japan. And what can you say? Drop Tsunagi was the technique that did it. He took advantage of that hopping Ojigari there from Nishiyama. Nishiyama just hops it through and just ran onto the Tsunagi. And it was the second stamp that won him his second title in 2 weeks. That is the third gold medal for Korea here, and they are looking superb. And Gwak, for me, is the pick of the bunch. At the heaviest male weight of over 100 kilograms, there was a dynamite semi-final matchup between Japan's Shinshinui and Russia's Sayadov. 30 seconds into the contest, Sayadov struck with his trademark Jujigatami, catching Shinshinui completely off guard, scoring Ippon. Sayadov was into the final. In the final, Sayadov overcame Georgia's Matias Fili, throwing the Georgian for a Yuko before securing the pin to score Ippon. A great end to the year for Sayadov. The top-ranked fighter in men's judo competes at under 81 kilograms. Aftan Til Shrikishvili of Georgia, the reigning world champion, was in Tokyo to underline his status as the top dog of the category going into 2015. He started in typical fashion, burying China's sea with Uchimata for Wazari before finishing the job off on the ground after a clever counter-attack. In the next contest, Shrikishvili used his trademark technique and the one that won him the World Championships, Uranagi. It put him into a semi-final contest against Japan's Nagase. Nagase had upset the odds and stunned Kim, the Olympic champion from Korea, in the quarterfinal when he launched this deadly hopping Ouchigari. Nagase would be going into the semi-final against Shrikishvili filled with confidence. Shrikishvili leading by a penalty, Nagase produced a wonderful piece of judo. A beautiful piece of ashiwaza from the Japanese, which scored Ippon and knocked Shrikishvili out. The final between Nagase and Toma of the UAE went deep into golden score. This near score from Nagase was the last piece of action and led to the defining penalty for Toma. After taking out some of the best fighters in the world, Nagase had more than deserved his Grand Slam gold medal. There were two great Ippons in the bronze medal contest. The first one coming from Germany's Weisesack, as he strangled Japan's Maruyama after just 30 seconds of the fight. The second one came from Shrikishvili, as he bounced back after his disappointment and produced a huge uranage against Brazil's Penalba. Shakisvili will be looking ahead to the 2015 World Championships and to defend his world title. The under 66 kilograms category saw the entry of Japan's triple world champion, Ebenuma. But it wasn't to be for Ebenuma, as he came up against one of Japan's young guns, Abby, in the quarterfinals. The young pretender drove Ebenuma over to score Wazari and end Ebenuma's chance of gold. As Abby stepped out for the final, he was up against Israel's Pollock. Again, one score settled the contest. Ayuko from Osoto gave Abby the gold medal, another rising star of Japanese judo. From new blood to experienced campaigner, 2010 world champion Akimoto was in action at under 73 kilograms. He produced one of the throws of the tournament in his semi-final, dropping underneath Azerbaijan's Orizov and planting him on his back with a stunning Sienagi. Ikon. In the final, he was up against the 2013 world champion Ono. As head coach Inui watched on, a close match was settled by Ayuko for Akimoto with his trademark Sienagi. Gold for Akimoto, another example of Japan's incredible strength in depth. And finally, to the under 57 kilograms, and to the headline act. Japan's Kaori Matsumoto was out to make a statement. Matsumoto has been one of the most successful female fighters on the IJF World Circuit, winning 4 Grand Prix, 6 Grand Slams, 2 Masters, and most significantly, the 2010 World Championships and the 2012 Olympic Games. But Matsumoto has an old rival that's been looking in good form recently, Portugal's Telma Monteiro. Monteiro knows how to beat Matsumoto and has done so on 2 occasions. Her most recent victory made it 5-2 to Matsumoto on head-to-heads. But the last victory went to the Japanese, who made it 6-2 at the Almaty Masters. However, that was nearly 3 years ago, and a lot has changed. One thing is for sure, there's no love lost between Matsumoto and Monteiro. Would they both make it to the final? Matsumoto started her day clinically, catching her opponent with a nice foot sweep before holding for an impact. Monteiro showed that whatever Matsumoto can do, she can do. After a lovely piece of Ashiwaza and then an Osotogari, Monteiro was onto her opponent's arm in an instant, prizing it out for an armlock and an ippon. Meanwhile, Matsumoto was again showing her strength on the ground, forcing a pin against Cuba's Ojeda. Montero's next fight, she got an early scare against Japan's Yamamoto, but she fought back with a beautiful Kano Jigoro. Matsumoto was making light work of the class act from Romania, Capriorio, scoring one Wazari with a throw and the second with a pin. Tight semi-final victory over Brazil's Silva, Monteiro was into the final, once again meeting a great rival. Who will come out on top this time? Well, the rivalry between these two, absolutely incredible. They've met 8 times before. 6-2 to Matsumoto. This will be the 9th time they've fought each other. And well, they're going to fight each other a lot as well, coming over the next year and a half up to the Olympic Games in Brazil. It's a real rivalry that is going to carry on right to the end of their careers. So who's going to come out on top now? Matsumoto is back with a vengeance. Monteiro on good form at the moment, so anything can happen. Osotogari, Monteiro. And Ouchi this time, and now she's into the attack.
Okay.
And Matsumoto says, come on then, we'll have some down there. And Matsumoto wants the Newaza for sure. So Montero, she knows she can beat Matsumoto, but Matsumoto, when she's on form, she is formidable. Almost halfway through the contest, Montero looking for that arm over the top, looking for the Ouchi all the time. Oh, look at that. Now then, is Montero, has she got it on? She's got the jacket round the neck, and can she get the leverage on it? And can Matsumoto come out of that? Yes, she can. And she's turning it against Montero. Montero is in trouble here now. Can she get it between the legs? No, she can't. Matsumoto goes into the hold down. And while we thought she was in trouble there, Montero looked to me as if she had the shimiwaza on. But now she's in trouble. The arm is trapped as well. And the look on her face there is all gone. Matsumoto looks up and a smile at last. And that was a nice bit of newaza. It was well turned. And well, Matsumoto is back after her disappointment at the World Championships. And on that kind of form, she's got to be a real threat to defend her Olympic title. Smile and a wave to the crowd as well. And this is how it happened. Well, Montero looked as if she had the shimiwaza on. And Matsumoto turned it against her. And now she just needs to control it. This is what started it. We thought that Matsumoto was in trouble, but then she comes out of it, and then she turns it onto Montero, and then has to get past the legs. She gets past the legs. Look how she wraps that arm up there. And, well, Montero knew that it had gone. Matsumoto smiles. She's back to her very best form. And 2015 looks very, very good for Matsumoto. And, well, what can you say? This rivalry between the two of them continues.
I was relieved to meet myself once again at the top of the podium is where I belong, because it's been a while since I've won any competitions. We recognize each other as rivals, so I was really excited to fight against her. At the same time, I was quite nervous about it, but I really enjoyed the fight. At the Worlds, it was the very first time that I felt the pressure, so I lost the fight against myself. But getting a gold medal here proved that I can beat the pressure, so I'm really happy now. I don't know which competitions I'll be fighting next, but I will do my best to win them all, so I can go to the World Championships next year to get the gold medal.
Well, that's it from the last event of the 2014 IJF World Circuit. Harrison showed you back to her best. Tresenya produced a beautiful moment at under 63 kilograms. Wang is heading the Korean charge. Japan flexed their muscle in the men's lightweights. And Matsumoto's back on top. So, it's the final curtain on an epic 2014 World Tour for the International Judo Federation. With five new destinations on this year's tour, judo has well and truly spread its wings as it continues to be at the forefront of global sport development by giving fans across the globe a chance to be part of the action. All whilst helping to spread the appeal of the fantastic sport of judo. The highlight of the year was without doubt the World Championships in Chelyabinsk, as once again the IJF's flagship event boasted judo's diversity and provided a grand stage for its athletes to showcase the unique blend of courage, athleticism and integrity that the sport embodies.